So good evening. I'm Jack Roger, and this is Chris Offen. And a few months ago, Beverly asked us to...
She hates you to call her Beverly.
No. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize that. She didn't tell me that. She only said, I haven't been called that for many years. So anyway, Bev asked us to try and put together something for an hour for the intermediate catechists. And the reason she asked us is because we co-facilitated an eight-week program on immigration here at the parish. So that's what we're going to do tonight. And we're going to start out, though, with a very brief introduction to Catholic social teaching, because you need to know something about Catholic social teaching to understand the basis for the Church's positions, the Church's teachings with regard to immigration. So that'll be very quick. Brief introduction to Catholic social teaching, 30 seconds worth of scriptural foundations on immigration. I'm going to present then the current positions of the Catholic Church on immigration. And we're then going to show a brief video clip. We're going to jump down one step here. Brief video clip on something we're calling the face of the immigrant. It's mostly an attempt to put some of the human side to this. What we're talking about in the packet, which you've got, is, I'll say it's dry. It's not terribly dry, but it doesn't present much of, it doesn't give you a feeling for the fact that there are people involved with this. And then Chris is going to talk about myths and facts on immigration, and some discuss something about what the Archdiocese of Atlanta is doing for immigrants. It's a lot to cover, and I did want to say that, so what we've done is we put on this handout the information that's going to be covered on the screen, and also there's a couple places where I've expanded on it for your where you can look at things later. Does everybody have a handout? Okay, good. So, Catholic social teaching in 5 minutes. Catholic social teaching provides the basis for the Church's positions on just about everything with regard to life in society, and with regard to immigration also. These are the core teachings, the core principles on which Catholic social teaching is based. First of all, because the dignity of man, because we are all created by God, and in Pope John the 23rd's words, imprinted with God's image, we have an inherent dignity that just comes with being human. Principle one. Number two, human life is sacred. The sanctity of life. Number three, we are God's children in one human family, and this leads to another principle called solidarity, meaning concern for the global community, for the good of all people everywhere, not just in our community, but in the world. Number four, all our blessings are gifts from God. We are stewards of our blessings. We're meant to enjoy them and share them with others. And then lastly, we have Jesus' words. For example, the well-known story of Jesus talking about feeding the hungry, providing drink for the thirsty, caring for the ill. And one of those was welcoming the stranger. Okay, those are the five principles. And if you'll flip to the back side of that first page, you have a full page that summarizes then how our Church has then described social teachings. Those are the principles, and the Church has provided seven themes then for social teaching that run throughout all of the teaching documents that you can find. So I'm going to go through them here in a much briefer way than you have on your page. You might prefer to actually just listen to me rather than trying to read along, because it might be a little confusing. But the first major theme is life and dignity of the human person. As I just said, the Church proclaims that human life is sacred, and that the dignity of the human person is the foundation for a moral vision for society, that is, conducting society in a right way versus a wrong way. This belief is the foundation for all the principles of the Church's social teaching. Secondly, the call to family, community, and participation. Basically, it says that, you know, we're not just dignified people, but we live in a society in which we interact with many, many other people. The marriage and family are central. People have a right and duty to participate in society and to seek the common good and well-being of all, especially the poor and the vulnerable. I'm going to talk about that in a second. Rights and responsibilities. Human dignity can be protected only if human rights are protected. Therefore, every person has a fundamental right to life and a right to those things required for human decency. Number four, the words are option for the poor and vulnerable. It's a translation from the Spanish. It means that we as a church, we as a people, give high consideration to the poor and the vulnerable. This was Jesus' teaching. He taught about this a lot. So, and Matthew, which I just mentioned, instructs us to put the needs of the poor and vulnerable first. Another principle or theme is the dignity of work and the rights of workers. The economy must serve people, not the other way around. And work is not just a way of making a living, but a form of continuing participation in God's creation. Work is central to being a human being. Solidarity, which I just mentioned, is concern for the entire human family. And lastly, God, care for God's creation. Care for the earth is not just an Earth Day slogan. It is a requirement of our faith. So those are the seven themes. On your handout, it's expanded a little bit more. And I'm going to show you also where you can find this on the web from the Catholic bishops. If you'll go to the next page, the next full page, I have on this page a listing of the primary documents coming from the Vatican and from other papal teachings that have come since 1891. And these are the documents that, along with the next page, summarize or expound a great deal more on various aspects of social teaching. If you'll go to the next page, this page is on documents from the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops. And in particular, and this is similar, so the Vatican has put out things and our bishops have put out documents. This one here, Strangers No Longer. It was put out by the United States and Mexican bishops. This is the primary document for finding out what our church teaches about immigration. Now, before I actually get to what our church teaches about immigration, let me just add a little bit about our scriptural heritage here. Well, first of all, aside from scripture, migration is a part of human history. Migration has happened since there were human beings. Anthropologists believe that human beings started in a certain area of Africa, and everyone here is related or descended from people who migrated. Even Native American Indians came over from Russia. That was the migration, or Siberia. That was the migration that occurred there. Migration is also clearly a part of the Bible experience. Scripture, it's very clear in Scripture. And just to pick a few examples, Moses and the Israelites, they migrated as refugees to Egypt. From Egypt to Palestine. We all know that story. That's where Charlton Heston, isn't that the one where he parts the sea? Yeah. Anyway, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, they were immigrants. They fled, or refugees, actually. They fled to Egypt from Bethlehem. You know that story. And Jesus later was himself basically a migrant. He was an itinerant preacher. I'm not putting him down. I'm just saying that he didn't really rest anywhere. So, if you want to, there is a, I mean, you can readily quote scripture as providing examples whereby migration is part of our story. Okay, so with that, here we go. The church's position on immigration. This comes from that document that's on the website that I'm going to tell you about in a moment, Strangers No Longer. It's from the U.S. Catholic bishops, also the Mexican bishops went together on this. Number one, persons have the right to find opportunities in their homeland. Now that sounds a little strange. I mean, so if we're talking about immigrants from Mexico, they have a right to try and find opportunities in Mexico. What they're really, I think what the bishops are really getting at here was, you know, people should not be expelled from their homelands because they're inconvenient or something to the government. Unemployment rates are too high. They have a right to try and stay in their homelands and and find work, find the support they need. Number two, persons have a right, strong word, this word right, persons have a right to immigrate, to support themselves and their families. Number three, sovereign nations have the right to control their borders. I'm going to come back to something here in a moment in terms of what might be a conflict. Number four, refugees and asylum seekers should be afforded protection. And number five, the human dignity and human rights of undocumented migrants should be respected. So undocumented migrants here in the United States are human beings. They have inherent human dignity as children of God, and they have a right to certain ways of treatment. So this is where our church is basically coming from with regard to immigration. There have been other refinements of this. There is the bishops have a committee that they formed some years ago called, that has to do with justice for immigrants. And from that committee has come some refinements on this. But this is really the basis for discussion on immigrants and migration as far as our church is concerned. Now, I did want to just tell you the sources for everything I've been saying are, first of all, there's a United States Conference of Catholic Bishops website, and the actual clicks where you go to find documents is listed there. The Catholic Catechism, I didn't bring mine tonight, but article number 7, which has to do with thou shalt not steal. That's only 16 pages long, and in the catechism is about this big, and it's got a tremendous amount of information packed in there. It's something every catechist should read. Strangers No Longer, I told you about that, and of course scripture. Those are the sources then. Okay. That wasn't bad. Only 15 minutes, according to our plan. Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to shift for a moment to, I hope we can do this, to our video.
Here that should be playing now.
Just eject it and then start it again.
Okay, here we go. Okay, is it in here?
Yeah, it should be in there.
Okay, let's put it that's a VHS. Okay, let's probably skip. Okay. And let's put the batteries back in the other thing.
Well, you know what? I could put it in my machine here.
Okay, that's a great idea.
We'll just play it off.
That's a good idea.
We'll just play it off with my head.
Yep. That's the best idea.
Looking for family donations.
Yep.
I think this, this.
You just gotta go back to the same source and then let's try to find the volume up.
Oh, do you have volume there?
Well, the volume should be kicked all the way up on the source. And then here's the volume, look, there you go, we got one, okay.
One comes from Oaxaca.
How
about the Hartman decision?
To make that a little louder.
Okay. There you go.
There are many struggling along
without
their home, family, and everything
they
do.
Okay, good. I'm not sure.
What drives you?
We went to chapter one.
Okay, we'll be quiet.
All of us, in many ways, are really passing through.
You're ahead of the face of the mic.
The person of the other.
Oh, jeez, you're right.
And nothing that comes as in the person of the ones whose society
it
doesn't want to run.
Oh, we'll just do it.
Yep.
We have to think about what kind of planet we want, what kind of world we want. And then
is that loud enough?
The future of our children. And the younger generations, and that's our commitment to them.
It's just real basic, you know, share what you have and do unto others.
The terrain ranges drastically. On the western end, we have mountains, boulders, elevation reaches heights up to 4,000 feet.
For many of the people who harvest our crops, build our houses, and work in our factories, this barren land in the American Southwest is their way to work. It's called the Devil's Highway, because the journey through here has been compared to a descent into hell.
The heat can get up to 110, 115, and it can just bake you, especially if you're walking for hours without water.
Since 1994, thousands of migrants have died here in pursuit of a better life.
McGill came from a small town in northern Mexico. He came north with his brother Louis, California 3 years ago. They crossed at the River Levy when Louis was just 16 and found work together in the fields of the San Juan King. They left their homes and family. Their father said, "My sons, one thing you will learn. For everything the North gives, it exacts a price in return." They worked side by side in the orchard from morning till day was through, doing the work the cueros didn't do.
Who are these people who are risking their lives to enter the United States? We call them migrants. We brand them illegal. We notice them hustling day jobs and working in our fields and factories. But we really don't see them, and we certainly don't know much about them. In a sense, they are a fuzzy background behind the fabric of American life. In border towns from Tijuana on the Pacific Ocean to Brownsville on the Gulf of Mexico, migrants meet to figure out how to make it across the border. The trip is becoming more and more difficult, both physically and emotionally. Juan comes from Oaxaca. He has made the heart-wrenching decision to leave his wife and children.
Hicimos un acuerdo, le digo a ella, te quedes, yo me voy a Tijuana. Y mi idea es pasar a los Estados Unidos, trabajar allá.
There are many people like Juan who have left their homes, families, and everything that is dear to them.
nada más me dan para medio día, mucho será para un día nada más, pero trabajo estable no hay, no he encontrado.
What drives people is la necesidad, need.
You don't leave your hometown if things are going well. If things are going well, you go on tourism or vacation, then you come back. It's when things are not going well, when there's a dire need, that you migrate.
A lot of immigrants leave places like this. This is Quilpan, Michoacán. And one of the most challenging for them, things for them, is actually just saying goodbye, not only to the people that they love, which is the most difficult part, but also a familiar setting.
Rural Mexico has a rich culture, and the people who live there have strong family ties, making it all the more difficult for migrants to cut those connections and head north. But in the end, it comes down to one simple question.
¿Qué me queda? What's left for me? In my village, first I sold my becerros, I sold my pigs, entonces me endrogué, then I went into debt, then I went to Mexico City, nothing worked, I had no alternative.
The Scalabrinians, an order of Catholic priests, brothers and sisters, runs Casa del Migrante in Tijuana. It's a place of refuge where migrants who are ready to make the trip across the border to the U.S. make final preparations, learn about the risks, and reflect on a journey most have made many times before. Jose has been crossing the border for 5 years. Manuel has been crossing for 10. Aldo for 10. And Victorio, the veteran of the group, has been entering the U.S. illegally for 18 years. It's all about building a better life.
Pues yo crucé aquí para los Estados Unidos con la ilusión de hacer un dinero para tratar de ayudar a mi familia, comprarme un terrenito y pues casarme.
Yo quiero una mejor vida económicamente, ¿me entiendes? Porque yo quiero ayudar a mi familia.
Pues no hay empleo, falta de empleo y todo eso. Y a veces hay empleo, pues pagan bien poquito, que pues no sirve para nada los sueldos, muy bajitos los sueldos.
Tengo necesidad de trabajo. México no nos proporciona. Soy egresado de la Universidad Juárez del Estado de Durango y no tengo trabajo en México.
Most migrants are men, but the Border Patrol is catching more and more women. Women are more likely to be caught and more likely to get into trouble.
Women are particularly vulnerable to predators, to certain kinds of men or certain groups of men who prey on women and prey on them sexually.
The stereotype of the migrant is an unskilled person with nothing to offer. But the reality is different. Migrants actually represent a broad segment of the human family.
I've seen people from all over the world. A lot of them very interesting people. They're just trying to better their lives.
Society may rob the immigrant of any dignity and self-respect. Quite the contrary is true within our own deepest spiritual values we have.
I'm amazed by the faith of these people. You know, they go through so much. And yet, they say always, Dios me va a ayudar. God is going to help me. And when I asked them, ¿cómo están? How are you? No, they told me, estamos vivos, gracias a Dios. We are alive, thanks to God.
There is the gift of empathy, of being able to recognize a shared humanity with people who endure so much.
El migrante es un hermano. El migrante es una persona que decide algo muy difícil: dejar su tierra, dejar su patria, dejar su cultura, dejar su familia.
Just a refresher of why we're here, and thank you very much for coming. I mean, this would be useless if no one showed up, so many thanks for each and every one of you to show up. But Bev wants to provide you with a perspective on various topics in adult education. This tonight is immigration. Jack made some compelling arguments from a religious perspective, biblical. And the movie, a short snippet of the movie, was really to give you a sense of humanity, a sense of perspective about who that migrant person is. Because in the press releases that we read in the AJC or any place else, many times the migrant person gets lost. Now my goal for the next few minutes is really to augment what you've gotten. So you've gotten a religious perspective on immigration, a morality. You got an emotional perspective. I'm going to share with you a secular perspective. And the reason why I've chosen that is because I think it's important for you to understand that it isn't just the Catholic Church that has a perspective on immigration. And the secular group that I've chosen is the bastion of capitalism. It's the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And now you may have different views about the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, but one thing that they do is that they do very good research on various topics that they pursue. And one of the topics that they have pursued, and they actually are in a multi-phasal relationship with religious groups to augment the misinformation that they perceive is being dealt upon the U.S. people by coming up with a list of myths and facts about immigration. So I'm going to go through each and every one of the five, I think it's five or six that I have up here. The source is the website, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. I would encourage you, if any of this tweaks some interest, to please go to that website and expand the information on it. So the first one is, I'm sure in your conversation at cocktail parties or playing cards or playing golf, people have these perceptions about migrants and about immigration. One perception is, well, migrants take jobs away. And if that's a perception, then their moral grounding as to why they're for this or that regarding immigration reform may be affected by their premise, their fact, that they think that the migrants take jobs away. Well, according to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, it's actually the opposite. Let's go through some of the facts. The U.S. economy doesn't contain a fixed number of jobs for which migrants and Americans compete. And what they mean by that is that if you pick a number, say 8 to 10 million undocumented people in this country, if one day everyone leaves, all 8 to 10 million of those individuals leave, they're not going to be filled by those jobs that they're doing are not going to be filled by the American citizens. So they're not really in direct competition on all of the jobs between the migrant and the American. And the reason is that the skill sets are different between the migrants and the American citizen. Today, well, 2009, fewer than 10% of Americans do not have a high school diploma. Less than 10%. To give you a point in time, back in 1950, which may predate some of you, 64% of Americans didn't have a high school diploma. So in this country, we've made a very big improvement on educating ourselves. And in educating ourselves, many of the low-skilled jobs, you educate yourself right out of them. And that's where some of the migrants have found the opportunity. Now, relative to migrants creating secondary jobs, there was a study that the Chamber cited that was done in Nebraska, Lincoln and Omaha, in 2006, where the migrants, the immigrants, actually created jobs, 12,000 jobs, by the source of their money that they got paid for doing their work. They bought food, they bought clothing, they bought cars, they participated in the American economy. And in those local areas, Lincoln and Omaha, they had to create other, they had to create more jobs in order to support this buying spree of the migrant. So the secondary generation of jobs has actually been proven that migrants do create secondary jobs. And last, there is on this slide, the research has further indicated that there's no correlation between unemployment and migration. In other words, the states where the highest percent of migrants exist, that does not mean that that state has a higher than that normal unemployment rate. And that's at either the regional, state, or county level based upon the research. So that's one set of factoids that you can use to talk about the myth of the jobs going away.
Try
that one?
Oh, it worked.
Okay. The next myth about migrants driving down wages. I know I've heard this one. It's kind of an extension of the prior myth, but let's reiterate. Due to skill set differences, the jobs that the migrants and the Americans perform are really interdependent. They're not necessarily totally competitive. As migrants receive their wages, they infuse into the local economy and have secondary jobs. So think about that. Here's a supply and demand issue here. So all of a sudden, the migrants infuse 12,000 using the prior study in Nebraska. 12,000 jobs. Now, local businesses have to hire help. Well, if there isn't an infusion of people there, then the demand for workers outstrips the supply, and the price and the salary of the workers go up. Strict supply and demand. So this is actually a benefit relative, they don't drive it down in some sense, on the secondary aspect of creating jobs, they actually drive up wages. Another study done in 2010, the Economic Policy Institute, indicate that the wage increase for the American citizen worker as a result of migration is actually positive. Now, I've seen the numbers, I didn't want to get too numerical on these slides, but they range from 0.05% to 5%. So that's a big range, and the difference in that range had to do not with the existence of migrants in the community, but in the educational level of the American worker. The higher the education level, the more separation of salary increases there were between the migrants. So relative to driving down wages, I think there's some compelling arguments here that this doesn't happen. Another myth, migrants don't pay taxes. Well, let's talk about this in two segments of the migrants. There's one segment of the undocumented workers who get paid strictly on a cash basis. But even then, they pay taxes because if they buy food, clothing, cars, or rent, they'll pay sales taxes. And when they pay rent, they help the landlord pay property taxes, just like anyone else, whether you're a migrant or an American worker. So the fact that migrants don't pay taxes, I think, can be debunked. Now, relative to the larger group of undocumented workers who seek a tax ID number and get a paycheck from their employer, they pay the same taxes that any other wage earner would pay. And getting a tax ID number, this is not a difficult thing. You don't need a Social Security number to get a tax ID number. You just need to apply to the IRS that you want a tax ID number, and you would suspect the IRS is very interested
in getting as many tax ID numbers out as they can, because then that increases the flow of revenue back to the IRS, because they work and the IRS can capture their pay. So there's no objection from the government about offering tax ID to whomever. Yet, even though those with tax ID and getting a paycheck pay their federal and state taxes and their Social Security and Medicare tax, the migrants are not eligible for the benefits of those areas that they're putting the taxes in. And we're going to get into that a little bit more in the next slide. This is a very interesting factoid. It's a little complicated, so let me try to make it simple. The Social Security Administration has various files which captures various levels of income and various levels of payment of taxes to that income down to the individual level. We all know that. Well, there's a file that is called a mismatch file. It's called, technically, it's an earnings suspense file that is a mismatch file where they put all the money that they collect that doesn't match the Social Security number or the tax ID number, does not match the name of the individuals associated with the number. And in 2009, there was over $800 billion in this file. And according to the Social Security Administration, a major portion of this mismatch wages and taxes associated with it are earned by undocumented migrants using fake ID or fake documents, which supports the fact that those that get a paycheck pay the taxes, but they don't reap the benefits. And lastly, this one we were able to find some Georgia information, not just national, but initially on the national, a household headed by undocumented people paid $11.6 billion in state and local taxes. So this is on the state level. This was on the federal level with the Social Security. In Georgia, in 2006, between $200 and $250 million were collected from undocumented migrants, just in this state alone. So to the argument that undocumented migrants do not pay taxes, I think the Chamber of Commerce has collected a lot of facts that would help you argue against that point. What about the fact, the myth that migrants abuse the welfare system? They come here and they, large families are from Mexico, and then they get all these benefits that other poor people get. Well, that's not true, because undocumented migrants are not eligible for any federal, that's an important aspect, federal public benefits, meaning Social Security, supplemental security income, temporary assistance for needy, food stamps, or Medicaid or Medicare. Even legal immigrants must be living here for a certain period of time, in excess of 5 years, before they're eligible. And at the state level, a number of state studies, including Florida, I was able to reference that one, has demonstrated that the migrants pay more in taxes than they receive in state or city benefits. And in this study, the difference was $1,500 on a per capita basis. So each migrant in the state of Florida who paid taxes, state taxes and city taxes, county taxes, the local taxes, not the federal, but the local taxes, they paid $1,500 more than the cost of the benefits that were delivered to them at the state level. So again, do they abuse the system? I think there's arguments from the chamber that would say that's not the case. And I think this is the last one, and then I'll, before going to the last slide, I'll open it up for questions just about the myths and facts. So the crime rate's higher with migrants. According to this group, which the chamber characterizes, I don't know the group, but the chamber characterizes it as a conservative group, found that the crime rates are lowest in the state with the highest immigration growth rates. So again, the myth is, well, when the migrants come over and they settle in my backyard, I'm going to have a lot of crime in my backyard. Data doesn't seem to support that perception. And studies conducted at the national and state level indicate that the incarceration rate are lowest for migrants, including Mexicans, Salvadorians, and Guatemalans. So, finish with this one. In 2000, the incarceration rates for young immigrant men was 0.7%, five times lower than the 3.5% rate of the young American citizen male. So, again, the chamber has collected some facts to debunk some of these myths. I think the last one, is a discussion about our local Catholic Charities of Atlanta Immigration Services. But before we go there, are there any questions about the myths and facts in general, or any challenges that you would like to bring, or perceptions that you've heard from other sources that would challenge this? I'm just using the chamber as my reference point.
It's not a challenge, but one thing that I see neglected is some of the causes, specific causes of why we have the immigration, especially from Mexico. I hadn't really thought about it, but it's like we have the free trade agreements, and a lot of the farmers, a lot of the people that have lost their lands, their homes and farms, it's because U.S. companies are shipping product to Mexico that's much cheaper than what they can produce it for in Mexico. So as a result, the farmers can't make any money. They can't survive. So they have to come over here and end up working for somebody harvesting crops so they can ship it to Mexico cheaper. So there's some, it's like our hand is in it too.
Right.
It's like causing some of the immigration because of I don't know if you want to call it unfair. It's just that we can produce it cheaper than they can, so it puts them out of work.
Right. And I think the crop that identifies to that, Pete, is the coffee crop.
Well, corn and grains. It's like the in Mexico. You know.
And also, Mexico lost a lot of manufacturing jobs to Asia during the whole, when everyone lost their manufacturing jobs to Asia. There's a perspective. It was touched on a little bit by the film, but it's called a push-pull. And that is that the Mexicans are being pushed to cross the border in order to create a economic income to help their family because of the collapse of the coffee industry was one identified. Mm-hmm. The transfer of manufacturing jobs to Asia, but also the fact that there's chaos and uncertainty in the local governments, and there's obviously the gangs and the whole narcotic point. So that's pushing them out of their home. What's pulling them into the United States is that the wages, even at the lowest level in the United States, is tenfold greater than what they could make on a good day in Mexico. And second of all, since we're in certain multiple generation of migration from Mexico, and again, it's not just Mexico, as we've read that on the newspapers, it's Central America and various other countries, that they have family now in the United States. Mm-hmm. So there's a pull here that people say, hey, life has its issues here, but it's better than where you are. come and stay with me and we'll, you'll get a job. So those push and pull factors that are creating this migration. And I think that's part of whether some of the arguments on immigration reform is that you can do what you want to the border and you can deal with whatever the laws are once you get into the United States. But if you don't do something about the conditions in the southern countries, in Central and in America and in Mexico, the push forces are still coming. So yeah. It's a complex issue.
This is all very interesting to me. I'm learning a lot, but then why? I can understand why they're sending all the children here, because their children obviously can't work in the fields mm-hmm. like a grown man can. Mm-hmm. So why would they be sending their children here?
Well, you know, that's befuddles me also. But I think they have different values, I guess. I certainly wouldn't send my children to an uncertain future in an uncertain country. But if you look at Honduras, that's the crime capital of the South. All the Venezuelan drug cartels that, with the funding from the United States and the help of the FBI and the CIA that were minimized or eradicated in Venezuela, went to Honduras. So Honduras is crime capital. So I guess the parents are saying, we know what the life is here. It's sure death probably before these boys or girls are 20 years of age. We don't know what it is in America, but the devil that we know we don't like, and the devil we don't know may be better.
Also, what they're saying is that the coyotes are prompting the family to send their kids because they're promising, kind of a utopia here. And the crime, the crime rates, if you believe what you're reading, are so bad that and they're getting a sales pitch that these kids would be a lot better off in America, having gone through all of the things that they have to go through to get here, that.
And you may want to give some background on who coyotes are, because I don't know if everyone knows what that is.
Coyotes are people that prey on the immigrants, and they charge them a fee to get them across the border.
Are those drug dealers sometimes? Probably.
They're brokers.
Yeah.
They're brokering
They make their money by...
They're brokering the migration.
And they charge up to $2,000 per person to get them across the border. Mm-hmm. And then not knowing what the situation is on the other side of the border.
Mm-hmm. Good point.
Are you referring to the recent?
Well, that's the only thing I know.
Going on with the children coming over.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm. the only thing I know. I don't know if
there's part of that issue has to do with a law that was passed in 2008. That was the intention to help children who were being trafficked.
Yeah, right.
And the fact is that children who have been coming over since 2008, there are now about 350,000 back cases of children who are living here in the United States with families, with usually their families, who have applied basically for asylum under this law from 2008.
Yeah.
It actually has a very good intention, this law, but somebody has figured out that the United States is in a position now where they can't just deport the children back quickly, like you can deport an adult who the Border Patrol catches, they can catch and release. And you can't do that with children under this law. So we've had 57,000 children since October.
I understand, but the adults don't show up with their children to either for their court dates. They let them bypass.
That's right. So years later, after they've been sent to live with a family, while their deportation case is being reviewed, years later, the case comes up, but no one shows up.
Right.
So, in effect, it turns out some congressman from Oklahoma, I think it was saying that, and he had looked over the data, the reality is that once they can get here and get into a family, they have basically come to the United States. They're still undocumented. They will always be undocumented.
Right.
And that happens to be, in fact, right now in the newspaper, day after day, there are articles about this particular situation, and it's gotten pretty complex and extremely politically.
But it doesn't provide a road to citizenship or anything like that.
It doesn't. Yeah. That's exactly correct.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Well, one thing that was the social Catholic teaching at the beginning.
Yes.
I remember growing up, and it's like the, what do you want to call it, propaganda, or just being naive as a kid in the 50s growing up, the idea that the corporation, the companies, had a responsibility to the community. And in this, it says, like, you know, like the economy shouldn't be feeding off of the people. It's like the economy should benefit the people. Well, there's just a lot of companies, they have no vested interest in the communities that they're in. And it's just like, I know Zenith used to pride itself about being made in America. When it got too expensive, they went across into Mexico. When it got too expensive there, by comparison, they went to some other location. And there are other companies, whether they're making tennis shoes or whatever, they go to an area and they use the area to me as much as they can. And then when they find a cheaper location or it becomes too expensive there, they pull out. And they don't care what they leave behind. It's almost like, and I hate to refer to this, not saying that Walmart's that way, but Walmart has a store and they build a new store down the road and they shut the other one down and it sits there empty for years until somebody else builds something there. There's just that lack of
connectivity to the surrounding area.
Yeah. And there's a point to where it's you that gets unemployed. You know, then suddenly it's personal.
I think Walmart is probably a bad example because they do provide a lot of jobs to
the buildings. I'm talking about just the buildings. Like up north.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
the buildings they leave.
They remodel buildings. We're down here. There's more property. We just go build somewhere else and just leave that.
That's a real estate thing. Right. Yeah.
Well, there are companies that they have a factory here. They can do the product cheaper somewhere else. They shut it down, move there.
Yep.
They can care less what happens to the people.
That's correct.
Right. Yep. Yeah. Well, no, I think you're making a good point, and that involves American citizen workers as well as undocumented workers, because in each of those countries they probably have both, and so it has an effect on both groups.
And
so
you wonder, like, where did they? Where did they lose that? It's like, I know some people maybe never had it, but still, at least it had the image of actually caring about, you know, when it was small town businesses, you know, they sort of looked, I hate to go back to, what's that, It's a Wonderful Life, that type of an environment where you actually cared about each other.
Right. Yeah, I don't know when they lost it, but I think your observation's right on.
I think sometimes it's when the regulations got so big that they couldn't work beyond them with the people, so they had to watch out for the viability of their companies. You know, I think a lot of that. I don't think they do it on purpose. I don't think that there's somebody in big companies going, you know, we're going to do this and turn the people here. I think that they're kind of forced into some of it. But I don't know. I don't know, and I'm sure it's different for every company. You know,
it's like if you got a milk cow. And a milk cow, and you produce milk, which is something that's provided for somebody.
Right.
And then somebody figures out, well, wait a minute, he needs money. If I buy that cow, I can cut it up into steaks and hamburgers, and I can make a whole lot of money real quick. So, goodbye, cow.
Yeah.
It's like they do that with companies sometimes. They make more money shutting them down than they did having them running.
I think they're doing that.
Let's transition to the Catholic Charities of America, of Atlanta. You probably know that it exists. What you may not know is that they have a division called the Immigration Services Division. It's a multilingual 9-person staff. The director of it is Jennifer Benzman. And their office, and she works out of this office, is down in the North Lake area of Atlanta, which is on the east side, just inside the perimeter. I actually visited her and went to that office, and the office, the sitting room,
the reception area where their clients are is probably no bigger than a third of this room. Mm. And it almost looked like it was a pediatrician's office because there was tons of kids and what looked like a smaller number of adults. Some seemingly with kids, some seemingly by themselves. So, and obviously, most of it was speaking Spanish, and I do not know Spanish, so I had a hard time understanding what they were saying. Not that it was my purpose to know what they were saying anyhow. In addition to the these nine-person staff, not only supports that home office, but they also go down to the Stewart, the detention center in Lumpkin, which is the largest detention center in the United States. This detention center is a building which houses migrants that have been found to infringe the law of the land, and they're put into this center awaiting deportation to their native country, whatever that native country is. They are down there providing legal services there also. Let's talk a little bit about what services they do provide. They provide low-cost, quality legal immigration services under the current law, which is, to a large extent, what Jack referenced, the 2008 law that President George W. Bush passed in his last 2 years. Jennifer Benzman's group, do family-based applications, and what that is that they apply for visas for individuals, regardless of age, that have come recently across the border who have family members living in the United States, and try to get a visa for that family member who's trying to visit the family. And this is all under current law. So we're not changing any, and this is not radical liberal interpretation. This is what current law is, and they're just implementing the current law. The asylum-based applications, that was, as I think Jack mentioned also, that if you're abused, that or if your life's at danger in the country that you emigrated from, and you migrate into this country, you have the potential of a certain number of asylum-based visas to be approved every year. Court defense services, they're in the Stewart Detention Center trying to defend the undocumented individual from being deported. They also do services for trafficking victims and victims of crime, an IU visa. You may also know by reading the AJC that your city here, Atlanta, is the number one destination for human trafficking in the southern part of the country. And the number one country that supplies these trafficking women, mostly at all ages, from 11 on up, is Thailand, followed by Mexico and Haitia, India, and I'm missing one other one. Haiti, and I can't remember the other one. And then also they have the, they support the visas for the special juvenile status. Here, this is just juveniles that can document that they've been abused. Not necessarily that they've been abused within the family setting or within the community setting. And there's visas that can address that. So those are the services under the current law that they're providing. You don't have to be Catholic, by the way, to get these services. It's not a prerequisite. They don't even ask the question what religion you are. And some statistics, just to let you know, I think they're incredibly busy. They're incredibly productive for a nine-person staff. For the fiscal year ending 2013, They served almost 6,000 clients for the first one-time view of a person, 6,000 of them, and around 1,300 of them is an ongoing basis. Those, you can probably assume, are in the system of courts, and they're waiting for their court dates, and they got filings to do and stuff like that, and they need an attorney, they can't afford it. And the Immigration Legal Services Division of the Catholic Charities of Atlanta provided. The ethnicity, 49% Hispanics, black 24, Asian 13. Socioeconomic, 98% is low income, 72% is below the poverty line. So the difference between 72 and 98, those are the people who they get some funding from. They charge for their fee. They charge a percentage of what your downtown attorney, either downtown Marietta or downtown Atlanta immigration attorney will charge. But they do try to get some self-funding through some of the clients that are not at the poverty level, but above the poverty level, but still low income. I found this of interest, and that is country of origin of these 5,800, 26% was Mexico. So just about 25%, a quarter of who they see is from Mexico, even though all the hubbub is about Mexican borders and everything. 75% is from non-Mexican. No way of looking at this. Cuba, 16%. Myanmar, that's the old Burma, in west of Thailand and north of India and south of China. 6% of that, over 300-400 people. Guatemala, 5, Bhutan, 4, Jamaica, 4. And another interesting thing is 39% is all others. And they have representation from Eastern Europe, the old Soviet bloc countries. They are religion agnostic, and they're also country agnostic. Whoever comes in the door will get prepped up, and will see an attorney somewhere along the line. So, just as someone that was really amazed by Ms. Bensman's effort and what they've done, I would encourage you, if you have any volunteering left in you, please consider there. And also, if you want to make a donation, I'm sure Catholic Charities of Atlanta would be more than happy to accept it and earmark it for the legal services. They need more computers. They need things that you would think an office that services almost 6,000 people in a year with 9 staff would need. And if you are an attorney, or if you know of any attorneys who are interested in doing any pro bono work, they would love to work an arrangement with that individual. And it's not necessary, at that level, it's not necessary to speak Spanish at the attorney level. But it is important to be able to converse in Spanish at the lower caseworker level. So that's it on the Catholic Charities of Atlanta, and Jack and I both hope that through the biblical view, through the emotional view, and through the secular view, that we've given you some ammunition to come to your own position on immigration and defend that position when questioned by anybody in the church or in cocktail parties or anywhere. So thank you very much. Thank you.